your benefits so that more and more grace can lead to more thanksgiving. And then he talks about a slight momentary affliction. That was a pretty risky move because he was talking to people who had done horrible afflictions. And they could feel like he was minimizing their pain if they didn't feel like he was with them, saying, if you trust, it can be well with your soul in spite of it all. And of course, by ourselves, that's not true. By ourselves, life sometimes seems against us and too much. The last several weeks, several prominent people have committed suicide, and it's been disturbing to people. And every suicide is not the same. Like, there's the infrequent, occasional suicide that's a very rational kind of end-of-life decision that's discussed with loved ones, and I'm not wanting to dismiss that difficult decision a person might have to make. But many people I know who commit suicide feel overwhelmed by life. They feel like it's too much, they're too alone, things are too against them, and they can't see a way out. And I don't want any of us to judge anybody in that difficult place. I want us to ask, how can we go be with the person in that place? Because that's what Jesus would do. That's what Jesus would have us do. So when we feel like life is against us, we need to be with other people. That's where the grace comes from. We need to be with God. So I went to my fifth child's graduation ceremony on Thursday night, and I was really moved by two things about it. One, they recognized a teacher who is retiring, who has taught at Pioneer High School for 41 years. His name is Steve Rodriguez. Now, Steve Rodriguez was a PE teacher, is a PE teacher, and he was my son Eli's favorite teacher in high school. Those of you who know Eli, that should be a pretty surprising observation. Steve Rodriguez knew how to be with students so that they knew that he knew where they were coming from. My son struggled with anxiety and depression and not well medicated and often wasn't at school. And at the beginning of the school year, I wrote him a little note and said, PE is going to be very intimidating for Eli. And I just wanted you to know what his situation is, and any help you can give him would be appreciated. And then I met him at the night they have at the beginning of the year for teachers. And so, of course, it wasn't just Eli. It was every kid loved going to PE with Steve Rodriguez. He knew how to be with kids in a way that made them comfortable, was healing and empowering. And they also, there was another person there who totally, Eli would not have graduated from high school without him. He's one of the most remarkable human beings in Ann Arbor. He's a social worker at Pioneer High School. His name is Jonathan Stern. And I don't know how this comes to be, but he's sort of up there at the front when they're handing out diplomas, and any young person who he helped, they let him step up and hand that person the diploma. And invariably, the young person hugs him, loves Jonathan. Jonathan Stern knows how to be with young people who are really struggling. Jesus is saying that people like this are signs of the presence of the kingdom of God where healing takes place. So I want to encourage us to not think of our strange scripture story this morning as some sort of special case that has nothing to do with us. You hear about demons, we don't want to go anywhere near there. And you hear about Jesus saying you could be guilty of a sin that can't be forgiven. We don't want to think we've done that. But what if we could all get into a bad attitude, a bad, disturbed spirit that doesn't see somebody the way God sees them? And what if then we're part of their captivity and they're part of our captivity, and there's too much against and there's not enough with? So Jesus, if you think about it, I've got to go get a tissue because now I've got a little emotional on you. Jesus, the number one thing he did that I think we have a false view about is he didn't just heal cripples and restore healthy limbs, which is a pretty good trick. The main thing he did was heal people who were disturbed in their spirit and in their relationships. What you would call an exorcism in its most extreme form. They had a new attitude. They had a new sense of self. That's the main thing he did. And if you think about how he did he do it like Harry Potter? And then the person's all better. Or sometimes films have shown it that way. Or did he do it like if you saw the two movies made about more Pentecostal preachers? One had Steve Martin in it, and the other one had Robert Duvall in it. And the Pentecostal preacher walks up to somebody and says something brief and then does something kind of flashy with their hands, and the person invariably faints. Those, either whether it's the magician or the Pentecostal preacher thing, it's not personal. I think the reason Jesus' family thought he was out of his mind, and the reason that this was so intense, is he made an incredible personal connection with every single person. He saw what their burden was, what their history was, and he let them know he was with them right there. And he wants us to be able to do that. And then they would pray together before God, and then the miraculous would happen. So I think if he's with a person in terrible anguish, then he was anguished. I think if he is with a person who's terribly agitated, he showed them, I know what your agitation is like. And so people could say he's out of his mind because he kept changing emotional registers with each person to make this personal connection so they would know he was with them before God for good. Yes, this is all for your sake so that more and more grace can abound. So what if God wants all of us to be like that? What if God doesn't want us to be captive to spirits that cause harm to ourselves and others, so that then whoever is doing what God wants for people, the will of God, is mother and brother and sister to Jesus? So let's go to the most worrisome thing in this reading today, the sin that can't be forgiven. Now Jesus just said all your sins and blasphemies will be forgiven. So you got to weigh that. Not just hear the frightening thing. When he says you sin against the Holy Spirit, there ain't no forgiveness. Is this because God writes you off? Did Jesus write anybody off? No. He didn't write anybody. I've been thinking about this. And this is where we can all become devilish. What cuts us off from seeing another person or God? Psychology says the most powerful emotion that does this is contempt. And John Gottman, famous psychologist, learned how to take a video of couples interacting, and then he slowed it down and he read people's microfacial expressions, and he learned to teach grad students to code them. And he realized contempt is the most dangerous human emotion for the positive outcome in any relationship. But when a couple treats each other with contempt, he could say that marriage is doomed. 90% of the time, he was right. That couples who knew how to cherish each other could survive a lot of affliction. So maybe the sin that can't be forgiven, and contempt is the more aggressive thing, maybe the more passive thing is resentment. Something happens, you don't know how to deal with it, you don't want to deal with the other person, so you start to resent them. And it starts to eat away at you and how you see them. Both these things cut us off from the awareness of God. So they cut us off from the source of forgiveness. So it's not that God's attitude has changed, it's that we are taking ourselves out of the game of being people who are about healing and reaching out and being with others, being not alone in judgment, being for others. So I realize that sometimes when I've failed in this regard, it's because I'm afraid to be with others. Or, like Jesus talked about the strong man that needs to be bound. I know how to help some people, like some of the time, put whatever's disturbing them aside and be together calmly enough for grace to happen. And sometimes I get afraid and I don't know how to bind up that aggression and invite us both into that healing space where something new can be. So I want to grow in that way, but I know it's about being with. And I know that there are people in this room who are really good at it. So, What if this is all not just this special story that you imagine in the first century, but this is something that happens every day, that every day we may blaspheme against the Holy Spirit when we regard another person with contempt or resentment, and let it damage our relationship with them, and they feel more alone and against. But what if we can all say, Lord, heal me, help me to be with people in a powerful way, like Steve Rodriguez and Jonathan Stern have done, like Desmond Tutu has done. And then the most powerful tool we have is the tool Jesus has, not magic, praying with. Now maybe sometimes you can't pray with because the person won't even sit down and let you listen to it. And then you pray for them. But I found quite regularly the most miraculous changes that do happen when two people look at some disturbance together with, know that they love and appreciate each other, and then they pray with each other for God to do something better. God's pretty reliable. And I find the miraculous can be present in any one of us, in our healing, in our relationships. So Lord, help us. Help us to support people who are struggling, for whom the phrase slight momentary affliction could feel minimizing. Confident that when you are with us, it can be well with our souls, even as we experience their anguish and their anger, or their depression, whatever it is, that together you will lift us and heal us and even take us out of a place that we cannot experience forgiving. Because knowing that you are forgiving and recreating, we want to be that way too. Amen. Amen.